Hello, welcome back to the channel. If you are new to this channel, thank you for stopping by. In today's episode of This Week I Learned series, I explored AWS Application Composer. Last week, I gave you a crash course on AWS CloudFormation and infrastructure as code. So if you don't know much about CloudFormation and infrastructure as code, I would say pause here. Go back, watch that video, and then come back here. So CloudFormation is great. You can define your infrastructure as code in that template file, and CloudFormation will read all of that and create all these amazing AWS services and AWS resources for you. However, these CloudFormation templates can become huge over time, and lots of customers or lots of folks want to use the benefits of these templates because they are reusable. You can do code reviews with them. You can just push them because they're code. You can push them to your CI/CD pipelines. But writing long, long lines of code or writing long, long lines of YAML and JSON files or templates is not something that everyone loves doing, right? So over the years, everyone was asking that, is there an easier way to actually define these templates? There are many, many different ways of actually interacting with CloudFormation. We will be exploring some of them throughout this series. But for today, I'm going to be focusing on the AWS Application Composer, which actually provides you a visual way of creating this CloudFormation templates. So because I started with little beginner friendly tools, I wanted to keep it also beginner friendly and look at something that you can do in the AWS console with the GUI. So for that, let's go to our AWS management console. Now here, I have already logged into my AWS account. I've gone to the AWS Application Composer as a service. We'll definitely highlight some important points that right now, AWS Application Composer is in preview. It was announced in AWS reInvent in 2022. If you are watching this in the future, when Application Composer is available in GA, you might see some differences, but as of today, it's in preview. So here you can see that there's a demo project that is available with AWS Application Composer, and you can just scroll around that demo project and learn about how you can create that. You can also create a new blank project, or you can reload existing CloudFormation template into Application Composer as well, which is something that a lot of people actually wanted. Then we don't just want to create from scratch, but we have something that we have already created over the years. We want to see that, how it looks visually in the AWS Application Composer. So go ahead, click on Open Demo. If you want to walk through, it will ask you, the first thing that it asks you is that, do you want to keep it connected or do you want to keep unconnected? Now, to understand that, you need to understand that this AWS Application Composer is actually running in your browser. It is not in AWS account. It's not in your AWS region. Nothing is stored in AWS. It's all running in this browser. So, where do you want to store the templates, the CloudFormation templates that this visual canvas is going to create? Where do you want to store it? Do you want to automatically store it on your local file system? So yes, then you go with the connected option. If you don't want it to store anything locally and you want to do all of that manual work, then feel free and select on unconnected. So here we are giving it an option saying, yes, I want to store these files locally into a folder on my machine. So I'm going to go ahead and maybe let's say create a new folder and call this demo app. So I create this folder, I select that, and it will ask me, do you want to give this browser or this website access to view this folder? I'm going to say, yes, you have access to view the folder, and it's giving me a green tick that yes, it can access the folder, and I'll click on create. Then it will again ask me, do you want to give the browser permissions to edit the files that are in this folder? I'm saying, yes, I want to give you permissions to edit the file. The moment you do that, you actually see there are a few resources that are already created in the Canvas because of the demo project. Now you could click on start and quickly walk through what are the different layers in this Canvas, but that's why I'm here, right? So I'm just going to say no. And you can see that there are a few resources that are already in this sample demo, right? Sample project. So if you click on list, you can actually see what are these different resources that are already defined. So there is API, there is items, which is a DynamoDB table. And then there is a group called as API Compute. So API Compute is a group. So you can ungroup different resources in a group as well. So if you want to add more resources, right? For example, I want to, let's say, add an S3 bucket. I can just drag and drop it, and an S3 bucket is added to this architecture. So if you go to the template, you can actually scroll down and see there is an AWS S3 bucket that gets automatically added. Let me quickly remove this and go back to template, and you can see there is no S3 bucket in this particular template. So that's how easy it is. So if I want to add an S3 bucket to the template, I can just drag and drop, and it will automatically add that to the template. There are a few resources that are already created for us. For example, if there is this API gateway, if I click on it, you can see that resource properties are available. So I can configure certain properties for this particular resource in the GUI. I don't need to go to YAML and edit them. I can do it here itself. So I can maybe change the logical name. Remember last time we had something like EC2 instance, EC2 instance 1. I can change the logical name saying, hey, this is our demo API. And I'll just say save, and it will automatically save those changes here. If I go to the template, and I can maybe search for it, but I can also go down, and there is it. That's it. So the demo API is automatically changed in the template. And there are other features like you can change the properties that you want. For example, there is a get properties for items. Maybe I also want a get property for customers, and I can easily make those changes, and that will automatically be picked up in the template as well. So I can do these changes. If I want to add something in this group, I can also add it into a group. So you can see that S3 is automatically added in this group. If everything looks at weird places, you can quickly click on arrange, and it will actually make it look a little bit more fancier, right? So this is about the demo project, but let's go back home. I closed it. So what happened? Did I lose the files that I just edited? I did so much work. What happened to it? It did not. Remember, I said it will be in your local machine. So let's go to Visual Studio, and that's the demo app folder that I created. And you can see that it has actually saved all the different items that I had mentioned. So if you go to template.yaml and I go down to, you can see that there is a demo API that was created, that I made the changes. So all of that is still available in my local machine. So I did not worry about not saving it. It automatically saves that. So let's go ahead and create a project. Okay. So I can create a new blank project, or I can load an existing project into this. So let's go ahead and again connect it. So where is my local project? So I have some sample templates. I'm just going to select those, and it's going to again ask me, do you want to give the permissions? I said yes. And for this example, maybe let's go for the S3 YAML file. Okay, once I click create, giving permissions, you can see now based on the template that I already had. So that's the template that I already have, S3.YAML. That's the template I already have, and it has a lot of resources in this file. So you can list here that these are the three resources that I've actually defined in that YAML file. There's an S3 bucket, there's a read-only resource. Not everything is supported with Composer today. So anything that is not supported, it becomes a read-only resource. And there is very limited things that you can do with the Canvas, but you can still edit that template file on your local machine, or you can edit it you're an application composer and it should be okay. I'm hoping by the time this goes GA, we'll have support for majority of services that we typically need for creating infrastructure. So here, let's look at a couple of things which are much important as a feature. Now, drag and drop feature is great, but there are other benefits of using Application Composer as well. So the first thing is, let's say I am creating, let's go ahead and first of all delete these resources. So I cannot delete this resource because it's currently attached to a read-only resource. So this is something that is in the preview right now. You have to go back and manually delete it from the template itself. So I'm just going to go ahead and select it and delete everything in the resources section. Okay, go back to the canvas and there's nothing here. So for example, let me just add an S3 bucket. Okay, so when I add an S3 bucket, Application Composer knows that there are certain best practices when you're creating an S3 bucket, right? So for example, a developer goes and adds an S3 bucket to the canvas, it will understand and it is designed to actually configure and integrate it with two important properties. One is that it should have bucket encryption, and the second is it should have blocked any public access for the S3 bucket. So if you go back to the template, and the one that I just dragged and dropped, if you see in the resources section, it created a bucket. It also created a bucket policy that you need for this bucket. Okay. It configured the bucket encryption by default, and it configured the public access block configuration to true. If you want, you can always go and change this in the template, or you can untick here and save it, and it will be removed from the CloudFormation template. You can do that, but by default, it will follow certain best practices. The second point is that, let's say I have an S3 bucket and I have a Lambda function. Now I want to say that S3 bucket, and that whenever there is some thing happening in my S3 bucket, it should trigger a Lambda function. So there is some connection between my S3 bucket and a Lambda function, right? If I make that connection, so let's remove this again. If I hold on to a connection, it will automatically tell me that, hey, yes, you can connect it to S3 bucket. Can I connect S3 to, for example, let's say DynamoDB table? What happens when I click on connect? You can see that I cannot actually connect it to DynamoDB table. The only other option here in this canvas is the Lambda function. So it knows that which resources you can connect to. And when I add these, let's remove this quickly. I go back to the template. You can see that it has added the S3 bucket and it has added a bare minimum Lambda function. Okay. Now, if I go back to the canvas, okay, the moment I connect the S3 bucket to the Lambda function, you can see it automatically adds code that, hey, the event is from the S3 bucket. It will also make sure that the IAM policies are configured for Lambda in this case, and it will also add certain scaffolding files that are needed for this particular function to work with your S3 bucket. So let's look at it again. Let me go ahead and disconnect this. You can see that it has automatically removed the code. If I connect it, it will automatically make sure that I'm adding whatever policies I need, and I'm adding that connection in the template file. So that way, it's quite smart. You don't have to worry about the different items that you add into the canvas itself. I can definitely do one more round of this. This is quite interesting. Looking at how it currently supports a lot of serverless applications, I'll be interested to actually test this out and create maybe a SAM application using Application Composer. But that is for another video. So let me know in the comment section that if you want me to have another video with SAM and serverless application model, and I'll let you know what SAM is. We'll explain it in a simple manner, and we'll use Application Composer to actually build a SAM application, maybe from scratch. So finally, remember that everything that is doing is in the browser, right? So everything that is being done is in the browser, but everything is being stored, because I went with the connected route, it's stored on my local machine. So if I go ahead and close this, I still have it all retained on my local machine. So I can continue using, maybe I load Visual Studio Code or whatever I love locally. I can do those edits, push it to Git, and let my CI/CD pipeline take care of it. And before I go, I always mention pricing on all the different tools that I'm trying out. So with this service, the AWS Application Composer, the service itself is free. So for creating the canvas, creating the projects in Application Composer, that is free. But if you are using the template that the service created and you're pushing it to CloudFormation, you're creating resources, you will be charged for those resources. So play around with the service, that's fine. But before you push it and create those resources, remember that it is going to charge you. So be responsible and go ahead and delete everything that you've done for the experiment. And yes, if you do play with Application Composer and you do find certain issues because it's in preview, we definitely want to make improvements to the service. You can have a major impact on the roadmap. Feel free to add those problems or anything you find different in the comment section, or you can actually in the browser, you can find that you can submit your feedback to the team directly. So that's it. That's it for today's episode. Let me know how you found it. Is Application Composer something you will find interesting? So thank you for watching. I hope this was an interesting episode, and I hope this was fun, and see you again next week.